Good morning, and welcome to our service today. Good morning, and good welcome. No, and welcome to everyone joining us at home as well. Bank holiday weekend, isn't it? Hey, this isn't global warming, all these thunderstorms. I seem to remember it always rained on bank holidays when I was a boy. That was the tradition, wasn't it? So. Nothing changes. I'm not sure. Have I got any notices today? I'm not sure that I have. If I remember what they are, I'll bring them up later. But our service sheet, if you have it, looks something like that. And if you don't, then the words will be up on the screen. So let us pray. Today being Trinity Sunday, Eternal God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, Lord of the past, the present, and the future, with body, mind, and spirit we worship you. Open our eyes to your presence around us. Open our hearts to your love within us. And open our lives to your purpose beyond us. Meet us now and help us to catch a greater sense of who and what you are, so that we might praise you. Not just in these moments set aside, but in every moment of every day, and to the glory of your name. Amen. Let us prepare ourselves to meet with God today as we pray together. We gather to meet with God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, to be aware of your presence in our day. For you, Lord, are here now. Your Spirit dwells within us. As we bring you our worship and offer you our praise, to be conscious that you walk beside us and we do not make that journey alone. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, draw near to us as we draw near to you today and every day. Amen. Would you please stand as we sing our first hymn, Bright the Vision That Delighted Once the Sight of Judah's Sin. A bit more volume, please, Dennis.
Thank you.
Sorry, I think I'll switch that off, honestly. Jesus Christ, risen Master and triumphant Lord, we come to you in sorrow for the things that we have done wrong and confess to you that we are weak and need your help. So would you join with me in our prayer of confession today? Let's pray. Holy God, we know that you are always there to lead us, yet we somehow lose our way and fall back into fear. We confess that we have stumbled, and we recognize our need for you to lift us up and help us start again. Forgive us our failings, restore us to strength, and reconcile us with you, ourselves, and each other through the power of Christ and the gift of your Holy Spirit. Amen. So may the God of love and power forgive and free you from your sins, heal and strengthen you by the Holy Spirit, and raise you to new life in Christ our Lord. Amen. Now, theme prayer, our collect prayer for this week. Holy God, faithful and unchanging, enlarge our minds with the knowledge of your truth, and draw us more deeply into the mystery of your love, that we may truly worship you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Oh, excuse me, a bit croaky this morning. Now, some weeks I put together a little introductory talk to set the scene for what's coming later in the service. I was going to do a little conjuring trick today with three pieces of rope. Some of you may have seen it before. I thought that was appropriate for today. A little twist at the end as well. Unfortunately, I've not had a chance to practice it properly. So those of you, I know my dad's watching at home expecting me to do something, so sorry Dad, but no little trick today. We'll save that one for another day. Instead, I would like to talk about we. Go with it. I assure you, it will make sense. My daughter Anna teaches 3 and 4 year olds, and you say we to them and you just get giggles and laughs, of course. But we, of course, are a bit more mature, aren't we? So, yeah, it wasn't until I was at secondary school that I learned the definition of what we is. In our English language lessons, I learnt that we, of course, is a pronoun. It's a pronoun, isn't it? Just as I, me, or myself, we includes others as well. That is what we is. It's myself and others as well. Except there is one exception to this. Can you think of an exception where we use we and it doesn't mean more than one people? One person? Yeah, there's a name for it. Can you move? There. Pluralis majestatis is the name for it. Yeah, my 3 years of Latin at grammar school has stood me in good stead, hasn't it? Translated, it means the majestic plural. And as someone at the front here said, it is the royal we. That's got nothing to do with sitting on thrones or whatever, but it's probably the one that we all know is we are not amused. We are not amused. Sometimes the monarch would use the term we because they represent the thoughts of themselves and their people. But perhaps in Victoria's time, the people were amused by the joke that was funny. And so what's going on there? And in the past, people believed that kings and queens ruled by divine appointment. They were in that position because God had put them there, which meant that they had to do what God wanted. And so rather than saying I, when they spoke, the I became we, because it is I and God together. So perhaps Victoria thought God wasn't amused by the joke, whatever the joke was. So what's the point of talking about it on today of all days? The Queen often used to use the word we when she meant that it was simply herself. Has anyone heard King Charles do it yet? I was trying to think, have I heard him say we? No, I haven't. Do you think he will or do you think he won't? I don't know. Well, why is it important? Why is it important? Well, I think so, because in the Old Testament, when we read the Old Testament in the original language that it was written in, well, actually, we don't, do we? Because we don't speak Hebrew. Well, I don't. But if you did, then you'd pick up something that doesn't come across when we read the Old Testament of the Bible in English. Because when you read God, it sounds like one God. God is one. But the word in the original language is actually plural. The word says, the word that says God should have the sense of we and us, even if the rest of the words that carry on after it give the impression that God is talking about me and I. God, singular, plural. One God? Trinity? Ooh, I'll let you work it out. Let's sing about this God that we believe in. Will you please stand as we sing? We believe in God the Father, maker of the universe.
Thank you.
And could we have our readings, please?
First reading is from Isaiah chapter 6, verses 1 to 8. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord high and exalted, seated on a throne, and the train of his robe filled the temple. Above him were seraphim, each with six wings. With two wings they covered their faces, with two they covered their feet, and with two they were flying, and were calling to one another, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord Almighty. The whole earth is full of his glory." At the sound of their voices, the doorposts and thresholds shook, and the temple was filled with smoke. "Woe to me," I cried, "I am ruined, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among the people of unclean lips, and my eyes have seen the King, the Lord Almighty." Then one of the seraphim flew to me with a live coal in his hand, which he had taken with tongs from the altar. With it he touched my mouth and said, "See, this has touched your lips. Your guilt is taken away and your sin atoned for." Then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, "Whom shall I send, and who will go for us?" And I said, "Here I am, send me." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John chapter 3 verses 1 to 17. Now there was a Pharisee, a man named Nicodemus, who was a member of the Jewish ruling council. He came to Jesus at night and said, "Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God, for no one could perform the signs you are doing if God were not with him." Jesus replied, Very truly I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God unless they are born again." "How can someone be born again when they are old?" Nicodemus asked. "Surely they cannot enter a second time into their mother's womb to be born." Jesus answered, "Very truly I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God, unless they are born of water and the Spirit. Flesh gives birth to flesh, but the Spirit gives birth to spirit. You should not be surprised at my saying, 'You must be born again.' The wind blows wherever it pleases. You hear its sound, but you cannot tell where it comes from or where it is going. So it is with everyone born of the Spirit." "How can this be?" Nicodemus asked. "You are Israel's teacher," said Jesus, "and you do not understand these things? Very truly, I tell you, we speak of what we know, and we testify to what we have seen, but still you people do not accept our testimony. I have spoken to you of earthly things, and you do not believe. How then would you believe if I speak of heavenly things? No one has ever gone into heaven except the one who came from heaven, the Son of Man. Just as Moses lifted up the snake in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes may have eternal life in him. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Dear Father, I do pray, Lord God, that on this day, day of celebrating you as a Trinity, three parts, that your message to us, Lord, will be heard loud and clear. In your precious name, Jesus. Amen. Morning, everyone. So, let's start somewhere different from those two readings that we've just had, shall we? Just for the sake of devilment. Revelation's description of the throne in heaven conjures up an amazing vision in my mind of what eternal life must be like. It's obviously it's only in my mind, possibly. At once I was in the Spirit, and there before me was a throne in heaven and someone sitting on it. And the one who sat there had the appearance of jasper and carnelian. A rainbow resembling an emerald encircled the throne. I wish I was as good at art as Michael is. I'd have probably had some sort of slide up here to show that picture. But I think it's almost beyond understanding. And from the throne came flashes of lightning, rumbling and peals of thunder. Also, before the throne was what looked like a sea of glass, clear as crystal. And in the center were four living creatures who had wings, and day and night they never stopped saying, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come." What a beautiful picture that is. It really is a lovely picture. And it excites me, and it's always excited me, ever since I've... It's not the sort of things you talk about, is it really? But ever since I became a Christian and I read that description of heaven, somebody conjures up some feeling in me that only that can create. And here in our Isaiah reading today, we get an idea of where that vision from the vision in Revelation came from. We only get a glimpse here of the kingdom of heaven, which we are told in Revelation 21, descends from on high. The further readings describe sizes, and for what could only be an infinite amount of size, because back in the Old Testament they didn't really have the word infinity, I don't think, and they used to have certain sizes to describe something like that. And the kingdom of heaven is described in modern language as 1,400 miles wide, 1,400 miles high, and 1,400 miles deep. Now, given the size of Israel, that is a big distance, isn't it? Much bigger than them. So I think there was this sort of indication of the size that it's going to be. And John wrote this, not to be confused with the John who wrote our gospel readings this morning. Or maybe it was, because it depends on what books you look at, really. Some people say it was him, and some say it wasn't. It was another John. But what he says is, there wasn't a temple. There was no temple in this new kingdom of heaven. Because, he said, the Lord God and the Lamb were its temple. Fantastic. It gets even better, doesn't it? Maybe you're sitting here bored. I don't know, but it gets better for me. And that, brothers and sisters, is what we have to look forward to. Now, in our Gospel of John, Jesus describes to Nicodemus how to gain entry into this marvelous eternal dwelling place. And apparently, there's no cost involved. No help from influential people will get you through the door, or whether you used to sit in the front of the church in the olden days, or you've got a tomb right before the altar. And even more amazingly, you don't have to rack up points either to gain entry. No green shield stamps are accepted. Do you remember them? I was always told that if something sounds too good to be true, then it probably isn't true. So why should we believe this description and this way of actually attaining eternal life? And I guess that was the predicament that Nicodemus found himself in. You see, he came to Jesus not with an innocent question. He came to Jesus with what I suspect was a challenge. And he was a Pharisee, and he was a member of the Sanhedrin, which means he was pretty important from a Jewish perspective and had lots of power. And he was no doubt impressed by Jesus' miracles, but probably wasn't convinced that he was actually the Messiah. So coming to him at night under the cover of darkness shows to me that he really wanted to believe it. He was trying to find something that's just going to tick the box for him. Well, in that case, says Jesus, you've got to change, Nicodemus. You've got to be born again. Now, to us, this may seem a strange... Well, it isn't to us, is it? Because as Christians, we hear this all the time about being born again. But to the world, being born again sounds quite strange. But in the ancient world, during and before Jesus' times, people were quite familiar with that concept, apparently. When a man from another faith converted through baptism and was adopted into the Jewish faith, then they were regarded as being born again. And again, listen to what this extract I've got here from William Barclay concerning the Greeks and the term that they called the mystery religions. Now, I know, I wonder why I brought my glasses, because at a certain distance I'm okay with my writing, but with this writing, it's going to be a bit hard. So here we go. So the mystery religions were all founded on the story of some suffering and dying and rising God. This story was played out in a passion play. The initiate had a long course of preparation, instruction, asceticism, and fasting. The drama was then played out with gorgeous music, marvelous ritual, incense, and everything to play upon the emotions. And as it was played out, the worshipper's aim was to become one with the God, that God, in such a way that he passed through the God's sufferings and shared the God's triumphs and the God's divine life. The mystery religion often offered mystic union with some God, and when the union was achieved, the initiate was, in the language of the mysteries, a twice born. Goes on to explain many other Greek and gods and faiths before the time of Jesus. So when Christianity came into the world with a message of rebirth, it actually came precisely, it came with precisely that for which all the world was seeking. And in Matthew's gospel, we have a different description meaning the same. He said, unless you turn and become like children, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. It's quite a definitive statement, isn't it? Unless you turn and become like children, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. In my mind, this convinces me that this is not an either or statement, such as if you want to, then go ahead, because it'll probably make you feel closer to God. Rather, it says that this process of change, this born-again moment, this spiritual attainment needs to take place in our hearts. And if it hasn't, then does that mean that we might be excluded from entering that place of eternal rest? Question mark. Now, that message is going to be received differently depending on who you are and what your opinion of a Christian faith is. Some may be angry with me for presuming something which you may not agree with and might be thinking, who's he to say that I won't be saved if that moment hasn't actually happened for me? And at the end of the day, it's not me that makes that decision. That's between our Lord God and us individually. I'm only a mouthpiece, if you like, to weigh up the evidence. Now, Nicodemus must have taken this conversation to Jesus to heart, as the next and the final time we see him is in chapter 20, when he, along with Joseph of Arimathea, asked for Jesus' body from Pilate. Nicodemus brings with him, and I haven't noticed this before, he brings with him, in modern day parlance, 34 kilograms of myrrh and aloes to wrap Jesus within. Now that can't have been cheap. And after all, maybe this was his gift to God for saving his eternal soul due to that conversation he had with Jesus. Numbers 21, 4 to 9, we're chopping all over the place here at the moment, but it's all part of our reading, describes when Moses led the people through the wilderness. Many were bitten by snakes. Some died as a result of this plague, which they actually felt was sent as a result of their complaining about why they'd left Egypt in the first place. We were quite happy there, thank you very much, under those Egyptians. God told Moses to make a bronze snake and to hold it up in front of the people. And those that looked upon this bronze snake that had been lifted high were healed. The purpose was to encourage the people to believe in the one who had commanded Moses to make the image and so rely upon God. The people of those time were quite fickle like they are now, and they started worshipping snakes, which was not the point. Jesus was explaining this to Nicodemus to say that the Messiah will himself be lifted up upon a cross. He didn't use those words, but be lifted up, which will turn men's thoughts to God, and they will then believe in him who has been lifted high. It's also thought to be an explanation of the ascension. Of course, when Jesus himself will be lifted up once more to heaven, and was to be seated at the right hand of God, the most privileged place in heaven. Now, for one of the best known sentences in Scripture, for us anyway, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, so that everyone who believes in him should not perish but have an everlasting life. Now, I've often wondered why God, or how God, can do that. Why would he go to that extreme of having a plan to save mankind that included within it the destruction of that part of him, to get over his point, to lead us into eternal salvation? God created, I believe, all that we see and experience around us. He made perfection, but he allowed perfection to make its own decisions. After all, when and if we enter into a relationship with anyone, trust needs to underpin that relationship. A robot works from a set of programs which, implemented at different times, perform a set of predetermined events. That's not a dictionary description, this is my understanding. We were never meant to be robots. God didn't create robots. Robots only appear to love when they are directed to do so. They have no beating heart. They never feel pain or happiness or joy or love. But we do. And that's how we are created, with perfection. But God loved his creation so much that he was willing to let that perfect creation make up its own mind. And that's what mankind did. And then entered into the world a rejection of that love born through us. We, royal we, I don't know, as in Christians, as in mankind, rejected him. And as a result, the result was that the only way we could ever hope of survival to return to the Creator was for him to sacrifice a part of himself to do so. He was willing to weave a painful solution into his perfect plan, one that would result in him suffering. John 3:16, describes the enormity of that love. But you've got to notice, it was the world that he loved, not a nation or just the good people. It was the whole world, the unlovable, the unlovely, the lonely who have no one to love them, the man who loves God and the one who never thinks of him, the one who rests in his love and the one who rejects him. All are included in this vast, inclusive love of God. But for those of you who are maybe feeling you're going through bad times at the moment and maybe feeling rejection, maybe these words from Saint Augustine can make a mark with you today. Because he said, God loves each and every one of us as if there were only one of us to love. And that really is good news. Amen.
Thank you, Richard. And Joy is going to come and lead us in our prayers this morning. Joy.
Heavenly Father, to whom all hearts are opened and all thoughts are known, hear our prayers. Be confident and trust in God, for he knows us individually, and open your hearts and allow him to be part of your life. There are times when we are gripped by foolishness, so take his truth and live in him, and keep your eyes on him when darkness falls. For he will give you a path to restore you. When tragedy strikes in our life, draw strength from him. And may we give thanks to God and ask him to hear the hearts of those in care or those with illness, cancer, grief, loneliness, long-term disease, to watch over them. And may his healing be with them. May we bless all those people who work on a Sunday, who would dearly love to participate in church fellowship. When someone decides to make changes in their life, help them to trust in their decision. And remember, if it doesn't feel right, then don't do it. But we are trusted not to harm ourselves nor anyone else, whether personal or professional. Don't be a victim. Be a survivor. Those who we want to hurt you or accuse you or lie or treat you cruelly, stand your ground in his belief in you and remember his commandments. Help us, Lord, not to gossip as someone else's life story is theirs to tell and not to be used against them. And when people grieve for loved ones or any type of loss, trust in your heart that whatever happens during or after the event, that others will support them and enfold them in fellowship or friendship to help them. Help those in marriages not to be blind to each other and to respect and to love and to trust in faith, to talk with no blame and rejoice in one another and guard against each other, keep each other from harm. Don't pour out hatred or accusation or use words that has been said to poison or sour your relationship. Help those who have authority over those to use their position and not to be ignorant but to love in exercising their power. May we hold all who have asked for help or healing to be blessed with the healing power of the love of Jesus Christ. And may God's blessing be upon this work. We hold all humanity in the power of the Son of God to work in the hearts of all people. We ask in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you, Joy. Well, alluding to the vision of Isaiah and St. John the Divine, let us sing our next hymn, which is Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty. Lord, is the greatness, the power, the glory, the splendor, and the majesty. For everything in heaven and on earth is yours. All things come from you, and of your own do we give you. Would you please sit? The Lord is here. Lift up your heart. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. The table of bread and wine is now to be made ready. It is the table of company with Jesus and with all those who love him. It is the table of sharing with the poor of the world, with whom Jesus identified himself. It is the table of communion with the earth in which Christ became human. So come to this table, you who have much faith, and you who would like to have more. You who have been to this sacrament often, and you who have not been for a long time. You who have tried to follow Jesus, and you who have failed. Come, it is Christ himself who invites us to meet him here and in our home. And so, with all our sisters and brothers before us, beside us, near us and far, we join in the song of your unending greatness and saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in his highest. Among friends gathered around the table, Jesus took bread, and having blessed it, he broke the bread and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup of wine and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. So now, following Jesus' example, we take this bread and this wine, the ordinary things of the world through which God will bless us. And as Jesus offered thanks for the gifts of the earth, let us also celebrate God's goodness. Lord Jesus Christ, present with us now, as we do in this place what you did in an upstairs room, breathe your Spirit upon us and upon this bread and wine, that they may be heaven's food for us, renewing, sustaining, and making us whole, that we may be your body on earth, loving and caring, now and forever, world without end. Amen. And as we prepare ourselves to receive this, our communion today, let's join together in the words of the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. Draw near with faith, receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, and his blood, which he shed for you. Eat and drink in remembrance that he died for you, and feed on him in your heart by faith and with thanksgiving. Okay.
Thank you.
Almighty and eternal God, you have revealed yourself as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and live and reign in the perfect unity of love. Hold us firm in this faith, that we may know you in all your ways, and evermore rejoice in your eternal glory. Who are three persons, yet one God, now and forever. Amen. Let's join together in our closing prayer of thanks. Holy God, we have seen with our eyes and touched with our hands the bread of life. Strengthen our faith that we may grow in love for you and for each other through Jesus Christ. Amen. God, the Holy Trinity, make you strong in faith and love. Defend you on every side and guide you in truth and peace. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be amongst you and remain with you always. Amen. Our final hymn this morning, Lord for the Years. Would you please stand? Just to remind you, there will be refreshments after the service at the back of church there. Do please stay. If you need to pray with someone, then there'll be the ministry team in the memorial chapel on your right at the front there as well. I think it's going to be showery this afternoon, but we might brighten up a bit. I don't think we're going to... Someone did say thunderstorms as well. So, hey-ho, bank holiday weather. Enjoy the rest of the weekend. And cheerio to everyone at home as well. But we must finish by saying something, mustn't we? So what should we say? Our service is ended. Our service must now begin. Hallelujah. Amen to that. Have a good week.
Splendor of a king, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice, 'cause he wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide. And trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. We sing together, how great.